Graphic Audio, a movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents the Nuclear Bombshell series by John Zakour and Lawrence Ganem. Narrated by Richard Rowan. With performances by David Coyne, Karen Novack, Colleen Delany, Thomas Keegan, Gary Tells, Ken Jackson, Nanette Savard, Terence Aselford, Patrick Bussink, Lily Beacon, Alyssa Wilmoth, Elizabeth Jernigan, Mort Shelby, Tim Carlin, Alexander Strain, Daniel Sonntag, and Eric Messner. The Plutonium Blonde.
My name is Zachary Nixon Johnson, and I am the last private detective on Earth. I'll get to the whys and wherefores of that a little later, and as you'll see, it's not exactly 100% true, but it sounds good, and hopefully I've at least got your attention now. The year is 2057, and after a handful of species-altering upheavals, earth-shattering cataclysms, history-changing extraterrestrial contacts, and pop culture disasters, the world is now a pretty safe place. I won't bore you with the judicial, economic, and anthropological minutiae of the New World Order, but suffice it to say that the sun still rises in the east, the human race is still around to notice it, and we still pull down the window shades, roll over in bed, and sleep until noon whenever possible. Of course, the world's not perfect. People still run the shades of gray gamut of good to evil. There are still cops and robbers, saints and sinners, voters and politicians. And every once in a while, some crazy thing happens that threatens society, all of humanity, or the entire space-time continuum. And for some reason, it always happens on my watch. I guess that's as good a place as any to start this story. It began like any other day, which is the way these things usually do. I was at my office on the New Frisco docks watching the tourists outside and trying hard not to think about how long it had been since good news had walked through my office door. I was also losing a game of holographic backgammon to the hollow image projection of my trusty, though occasionally annoying, computer compatriot Harv.
So I catch this Simfolk security guy red-handed, stealing parts from the droid manufacturing plant. And I mean literally red-handed. He was smuggling a handout in his lunchbox. You know what I mean?
Oh yes, I understand the irony of the situation.
For some reason, whenever he projects himself, Harv likes to take the form of an elderly balding gentleman. I guess he thinks that it gives him an air of distinction.
Okay, so I say to the guy, "All right, buddy, hand over the hand," which I thought was pretty funny. But he runs into the spare parts room, grabs a droid femur, and takes a swing at me. "How about I give you a leg up instead?" he says. And from there, the body parts and the puns just started flying left and right. "No thanks, I'm already armed. Nice suit. Is it double-breasted? Now that's what I call a bowel movement." Finally, I grab a couple of droid heads, one in each hand, and slam him upside his head like a pair of cymbals. He falls unconscious to the floor and... I can't believe I do this. But I stand up and say out loud, "I guess two heads really are better than one."
I'll bet he was really disturbed at that turn of events.
It's a joke, Harv.
Actually, I think the term humorous anecdote is more accurate.
Either way, it's supposed to be funny. You get it?
Well, I understand the anatomical references and your use of common phraseology in an ironic manner. But wouldn't it have been more accurate for your last line to have been, "I guess two android heads, when used as blunt trauma-inducing weapons, can cause severe concussive damage"?
Forget it. I should have known better than to waste the story on a computer.
Yes, well, forgive me, boss, if I don't quite grasp the subtle concept of witty PI banter. I guess I'll just have to be content with the ability to perform 3 billion separate calculations in a nanosecond. Frankly, I'm surprised that you managed to survive all those years without me. Now, if you will kindly just roll the dice and take your turn, I am anxious to claim yet another victory.
How about this? A guy walks into a bar with two chunks of plutonium sewn under the shoulders of his shirt.
Yes, I know. Please, spare us both the anguish and roll the dice.
I shook the two holodice that weren't really there, even though a good portion of my brain thought they were, for an annoyingly long time, just to get on Harv's circuits a bit, and then made my roll. The dice bounced around the holographic backgammon board, which also wasn't really there, much as you would expect real dice to bounce around on a real backgammon board, although not quite.
Oh my. Double sixes.
There are times, most times actually, when double sixes is a good roll. This, however, was one of those rare instances when it wasn't. Harv had my captured piece solidly blocked in, with two of his four remaining pieces sitting squarely on the number six slot. I was trapped.
I find it hard to believe that you're not loading these dice. I've rolled three doubles this game, and every one of them's been worthless.
Oh, please. I am the most sophisticated computer on Earth. Why would I want, or for that matter, why would I need to cheat to win a simple game of backgammon? Besides, your third roll of the game was a double two, which you found quite useful. Perhaps you wish me to replay it for you on the wall screen in super slow motion.
I'll take your word for it.
As well you should, as I have no reason to lie. You have simply run into a series of unfortunate but very possible circumstances in this game of chance. Dice in motion are random objects, as you know, and subject to all laws of probability. Results of such probabilities cannot be accurately predicted nor controlled. It is the chaos theory in action.
What I want to know is, how come the chaos theory always seems to be in action when it's my turn to roll the dice?
Harv's holographic image picked up the holodice.
If you don't mind my saying so, boss, you are fixating on the negative. You should be thankful that your bad luck at this gaming table does not necessarily translate into bad luck in the more important areas of life. You are, for instance, very fortunate when it comes to armed combat. You have been fired upon 127 times in your career and have been wounded only thrice, each of those minimally so. You are also quite fortunate in the area of romantic interpersonal relationships. Or have you forgotten the lovely Dr. Electra Guevara? Quite honestly, your luck in this area is truly an example of the chaos theory run amok. Even I, the most sophisticated computer on Earth, have trouble computing what exactly such a beautiful and intelligent surgeon sees in you.
There are some things, Harv, that are beyond even your abilities.
True, but they are few and far between. Ah, double sixes.
As I mentioned earlier, there are a few rare instances in backgammon where double sixes can be a bad roll. This, of course, was not one of those times.
Oh my, it appears as though I've won a game. If I were counting, this would mark my fifth victory in a row and my 10th victory over the last 11 games. It would also be my 94th victory in the last 99 games, and my 500th victory
in then, you're not one to count, are you, Harv?
Of course I am. I'm a computer. It's what I do.
That's it. We're using real dice and a real board next game.
Fine. Bring them out.
I don't have any.
What was that?
I said I don't have any real dice. I don't think they make them anymore.
Just as well. You probably wouldn't know how to work them anyway.
Excuse me, but whatever happened to helping me count my blessings?
Ah, yes, your blessings. Well, aside from surviving numerous altercations involving heavy ordnance and being romantically involved with someone several steps above you on the social register, you also have what one would describe in the current vernacular as a way groovy job.
I'll tell you now, there's something very strange about hearing the world's most intelligent computer use the term way groovy. But I'd grown accustomed to Harv's eccentricities. I am considered by many people, most people who know me actually, to be a bit of a throwback to a bygone era. Why else would I choose to be a private eye in the 21st century? Personally, I like to think of myself more as a Renaissance man, living comfortably in the present, but fascinated with the past. Truth to tell, I was born in the wrong century. I'm endlessly, some would say compulsively, fascinated by anything and everything Twen Sen. It was a simpler time when everybody wasn't wired to everything else. It was a more stylish time. A better time? Hey, I'm not naive. But the cars were a lot cooler back then, and in my book, that counts for a lot. I've been a licensed private eye for 13 years. I got into the business in what they call a downtime. It was the height of the age of information, and the general public, who at that time had the world at their fingertips and eyeballs via the cellular net, had no real use for investigators. After all, you don't need someone to dig up dirt for you when you're standing in the middle of a dust bowl. True, it takes a special skill to know the right place to dig, but it's hard making that argument when the caffeine corner down the street is giving away copies of the Complete and Unabridged History of History, Volumes 1 and 2, on a nanochip, free with every purchase of a quadruple latte. So, over the next few years, the rank and file of the gumshoe population dwindled substantially. The old-timers, some of them grand old men from the heyday, living, breathing specimens of Marlowe-esque history, gave up the game. A lot of them passed away over the years. Many just retired and moved to New Florida. 10 years ago, the World Council stopped issuing licenses, and private eyes became an endangered species. Before I knew it, I was the last licensed guy on the PI register, and the associate partner position at my buddy Randy's software R&D lab was becoming a very real temptation. To make matters worse, the PI void was about to be filled by the seamy underside of society. No, not organized crime. The entertainment industry. Entercorp, the world's largest entertainment conglomerate, realized that there was a profit to be made from human misery and suffering by recording and netcasting it to the masses. Entercorp created a private eye subsidiary corporation they ironically called Dickco, and the company now does a lot of the work formerly done by freelance PIs. They actively recruit PI wannabes, thugs mostly, and employ them to do investigative work. Totally unlicensed, of course. Who cares about a license, after all, when you have the shadow support of the third largest corporation in the world behind you? Basically, Dickco assigns its operatives regular cases, covers all their expenses, and pays them a regular, comfortable level salary. Operatives go where they're told to go, investigate what they're told to investigate, and bust whatever heads they are unofficially told to bust. It's a sweet life, if you're a thug with highbrow pretensions. Unfortunately, the world still has its fair share of those. It just goes to show that there's a big difference between a PI and a dick. Why does Entercorp do it? Well, part of the package that comes with your signing on the virtual dotted line is that Dickco has the right to record your actions at all times, 24/7, and netcast your work-related experiences on any of their many reality-based net shows. All operatives are fitted with netcast cameras that are surgically attached to their retinas. I like to call them dick cams. Tracking devices are implanted in their necks, so in a pinch, satellite cameras can locate them to get dramatic overhead shots of their adventures. And the most popular of the rank and file get what they call netcast and ones. That's a sidekick whose sole job is to dutifully get the proper coverage of the operative, and sometimes provide comic relief or a sounding board in order to easily provide exposition. Entercorp made me an offer when they were just starting up. Needless to say, I thought the term stunk worse than an angry, unwashed skunk eating old fish and extra stinky cheese, and I turned them down flat. Still, I didn't want to quit the PI business. After all, what other job lets you set your own hours, carry a cool gun, and get paid to snoop around? Then, 5 years ago, I had, for lack of a better term, my breakthrough case. I won't bore you with the details, but it involved YOM, which was short for Yesterday Once More. They were a teleport delivery service that promised to deliver packages back through time. Their motto was, when it really should have been there yesterday. The city council, at the very strong urging of Fedport, YOM's competition in the delivery service market, was worried that traveling so casually back and forth through time threatened the world as we know it, and hired me, of all people, to set things right. There was a budget crisis, and the city hadn't allocated much money for protecting the fabric of time, so I was all they could afford. Within a week, I had shut YOM down, and reality as we knew it was safe once more. Actually, it turned out that YOM wasn't really delivering packages through time at all. They were just hypnotizing their customers through subliminal advertisements to convince them that they'd received the packages the day before. So, all they'd really saved the world from was false advertising. Still, the press latched onto the story for a time, and I began what I thought would be my 15 nanoseconds of fame. Then it was discovered that I was actually the last legally licensed private investigator on Earth, and that sort of gave new life to my marketability. A week later, I was hired as the private bodyguard for that teenage Holovision starlet. I can't remember her name. You know, the one with the hair. After that, I did talk shows in the net circuit. A year later, I saved the city when a deranged pilot tried to crash a Twensen satellite in a fisherman's wharf, and since then, I've been a bit of a minor celeb in this part of the world. I haven't exactly stayed 100% true to the Sam Spade mold, but every organism learns one way or the other that when the times are changing, you either adapt or die.
By the way, boss, we received our first of what could be several angry overdue rent notices this morning from your landlord.
What do you mean, overdue? Didn't you pay the rent?
I've been dragging my feet, so to speak, on the finances in general.
Any particular reason why?
Well, at the moment, your finances are stretched a bit thin. A few client payments are overdue, and your residual check from the last net special was, shall we say, underwhelming.
Yeah, maybe Randy was right and we should have called it Zach Johnson versus the Bikini Babes from the Planet Bimbo 38D.
Be that as it may, you're not at the Nano, as they say, flush with investable capital.
So, we need to raise some creds in a hurry.
As always, boss, your keen grasp of the obvious overwhelms me. And may I take this opportunity to remind you of the very generous offer extended to you last week by the good people at Omega Mart to celebrate their new store opening.
Forget it.
It's good money for a simple personal appearance.
Forget it, Harv. I'm not doing it. Gates, I'd rather do anything than another one of those pebcac ribbon-cutting ceremonies. And just then, three cheap-looking thugs in expensive-looking suits crashed through my office door, turning the simulated wood into so much simulated kindling. My first reaction was, why don't thugs ever try the knob? Which, however incisive, wasn't very much help at the time. My second reaction was, this is not a good thing. Which was more pertinent to the matter at hand, but overly obvious. And again, not all that useful. This is why I never trust my first two reactions to any crisis situation. Carol, my secretary and probable future niece-in-law, followed the thugs into the room, shrugging her little shoulders apologetically. Carol is an extremely smart girl, brilliant actually. She is the mind of a world-class physicist. She's the niece of my fiancé, Dr. Elektra Gavada, and when she's not attending classes at the university, she works part-time as my receptionist. One other thing, she's also a Psi, which is short for Psionic, Class 1 Level 5, which makes her exceptionally powerful. However, because she's young, her talents are still a bit raw. She's very gifted at reading minds and only slightly less skillful at mind control. She has trouble at times with her telekinesis, and she tends to lose that ability under pressure, but hey, she's just a kid, and you can't really expect her to be perfect. Besides, she's cute as a button. She's been recruited by nearly every government corporation and gaming casino in the New World. Psis are rare and in high demand in the business world. She was even kidnapped once by a fifth world country in the hopes that she'd become their secret weapon and the key to their world dominance. That actually got a little ugly, and as a result, I'm no longer able to purchase my favorite brand of macaroons. But, that's another story.
Sorry, Tio. My mind blasts didn't stop them.
The menacing thugs, with blasters drawn, formed an ominous semicircle around my desk. Smart guy that I am, I realized then that this day wasn't going to be so ordinary after all. When facing an imminent confrontation with multiple thugs, the PI Handbook, now long out of print in both paper and electronic versions, strongly suggests that you remember the acronym WEPN, spelled W-E-P-N. W, wits, keep them about you. E, evaluate your foe's strengths. P, postulate their weaknesses, and assign each foe a slightly demeaning N, nickname. It will subconsciously help your fighting skills if you convince yourself that your opponent is someone known as, for example, Bedwetter. These particular thugs in front of me were clearly hired muscle. Big men, one of them truly immense, in big suits with big ugly scowls on their faces. Working from left to right, our contestants were... Stupid Ape. I had to qualify this with the word stupid so as not to offend the ape community. Large of limb, impotent of intellect, he was the kind of guy who lettered in leg-breaking at thug school, but flunked the written exam because he didn't know which end of the pencil to use. Fuzzface. I pegged this guy as the boss. My first clue was that he stood in the middle. Let's face it, when you're dealing with thugs, the boss always stands in the middle. They're a lot like geese in that respect. He also looked a little less animal-like than the other two. Shades hit his eyes, and a dirty little mustache and goatee stippled his chin. Both these goons were packing high-power hand blasters, which of course were aimed directly at me. Man Mountain. Stupid Ape and Fuzzface were trouble, but this guy brought the situation up a few levels on the danger meter, right up to, uh-oh, did I pay this month's premium on my life insurance? First off, he was immense. I've said that before, I know, but I want to make sure I do him justice here. He was 2.5 meters tall and very nearly as wide. To this guy, the Bahamian diet was something you try because you've already eaten Jamaica and St. Croix. Clearly the guy was GE, genetically engineered. Thugs that size just don't come from Mother Nature. And this set off all kinds of alarms in my head. It takes a pile of credits to get a GE. They've been outlawed since 2035, so I knew right away that I was up against a goon squad who had some hefty financing behind them. Fuzzface spoke first, further strengthening my belief that, of the outfit, he was the brains, such as they were.
Zakour Johnson, you're coming with us.
Don't they teach manners in thug school anymore?
Manners don't mean much when you got a blaster pointed at your face. Now, like I said, you're coming with us. Alive or in pieces, it don't matter to me.
My. When it comes to kidnapping, you fine gentlemen certainly are in the dark.
What are you... Hey!
Harv had taken my cue and killed the office lights and shaded the window screens to black, plunging the room into total darkness and utter confusion.
Huh? What happened?
Just then, the lights blinked back on, and my three thug friends suddenly found themselves faced with 15 identical versions of yours truly.
Huh? How'd you do that?
They're holograms, you idiots! But one of them is the real thing.
Fuzzface turned and aimed his blaster at the wall screen covering Harv's power unit.
We just need to take out the computer and...
The real me chose that moment to leap at Fuzzface from the crowd of holograms and nail him with a hard snap kick to the groin. Not very sporting, I know, but what do you want? He was gonna shoot my computer.
Didn't your mother ever teach you not to pick on defenseless and very expensive computers?
Unfortunately, my move surprised Harv as much as it did the thugs, because when I moved on Fuzzface, the hologram images of me all remained motionless. And that pretty much blew my cover. Stupid Ape was quick to take advantage of the opening. I managed to remain on my feet, thanks mostly to the wall I hit, and came right back at him. A look of confusion crossed his face as I rushed him. I mean, above and beyond his normal level.
What can I say, buddy? You must be losing your touch.
Actually, that punch would have cracked my ribs like eggshells had it not been for the armor I wear. It's a light but extremely strong carbon alloy, specially designed for me by my good buddy Dr. Randy Poole. It protects me from heavy blows and even light blaster fire. It gets a little itchy in warm weather, but a man who makes a living poking his nose into places where it doesn't belong can never be too careful.
Next thing you know, you'll develop a glass jaw!
A wonderful look of total shock and confusion swept over the thug's face as he flew backwards over my desk. If there's one thing I've learned in my many years as a PI, it's that sometimes you need to cheat a little bit to survive. Let's face it, St. Peter's parlor is standing room only with guys who tried to fight fairly. My armor helps me cheat. On top of protecting me, it's also soft-wired to my muscles, which means that in times of need, I can draw juice from its circuits, channel it directly into my arms or legs, and basically give myself a quantum-sized helping hand. Yeah, it's cheating. I'm not as tough as these thugs think I am. But remember, I'm not the one who came into the room waving his blaster around. Unfortunately, in this case, I'd used my trump card a little too soon. Two thugs were down, but my luck was about to run out because Man Mountain chose that nano to join the fray. I knew this because a fist the size of my desk chair swatted me from the side. I felt this blow, even through the armor. And this time when I hit the wall, I felt it crack. At least, I hoped it was the wall. Man Mountain gathered me up and used his massive girth to drive me into the wall that housed Har's computer screen. I quickly juiced up my fist with energy from the body armor and countered with a jab to his gut.
Uh-oh.
He wrapped his fingers around my throat.
You're not so tough enough, eh? I'm made in 2029 before test spend. Made real strong.
And exceptionally bright, too.
I flicked my left wrist in just the right way, and my trusty Colt 45 version 2A popped neatly into my hand from its forearm holster. Guns are nasty, messy items, but there are times when nasty is called for. Messy is just something you have to live with. But Man Mountain had somehow anticipated this move and reacted with surprising speed. His free hand grabbed my arm and pinned it, gun and all, firmly against the wall. Then he gave me one of those, ha-ha, you're even dumber than I am smiles, which was especially nasty because in this case, it rang so true.
I talk not good, but I smarter than words. When I strangle you, your armor I know you wear no help.
He began tightening his grip on my throat with his giant atomic vise of a hand, and I began to regret not ordering the armor in the turtleneck style.
Okay, I guess I'll come along quietly now. Where are we headed?
What you say? I not hear you. Oh well.
I felt my eyes roll back in my head, and the world turned gray around the edges. The dark void opened before me, and I felt the urge to let the peaceful shadows cover me in the big sleep of nevermore. I always get way too metaphoric when I'm about to die. On the bright side, Harv was up and fully operational, and Carol was ready to use her psi powers or her fists to do whatever she could. On the not-so-bright side, Carol's psi attacks had so far been ineffective against Man Mountain, and her fists even less so. She was currently whacking away at his back with a chunk of the broken coat rack, but Man Mountain hardly seemed to notice. As for Harp, well, he's not exactly programmed for violence. And in times of emergency, he tends to retreat into a semi-neurotic shell of random probability analyses. Right now, he was calculating the odds of my being saved by a violent tsunami striking the area. As a result, neither he nor Carol was able to do anything other than watch helplessly as Man Mountain gleefully continued to squeeze my throat, as though he were wringing out a damp washcloth that he really hated.
You die soon! Kill you, then have fun with your secretary! And she not able to stop me!
And there was the rub. Under normal circumstances, Carol should have been able to freeze Man Mountain with a glance, turn his gray matter into a frozen daiquiri, and have him dance the bossa nova with an office chair. Yet for some reason, she couldn't penetrate his cranium. All of the thugs had to be wearing psi blockers, and that set off a whole new round of alarms in my head. Psi blockers are experimental, they're government issue only, and tend to liquefy the internal organs of the wearer if worn too long. Apparently, though, that was a risk that Man Mountain, or whomever sent him, was willing to take.
Harp! Scan his head!
Scan for what?
For a psi blocker, I wanted to say, but my air was just about gone.
Well, he's ugly. As ugly as he is massive, although those two qualities are difficult to compare. One being objective, the other being totally subjective. His nose is roughly the size of an adult athletic shoe. The inner lining is also slightly hairier than normal, which, although considered disgusting by contemporary human standards, is relatively common in genetically engineered beings. I, for one, am certainly glad the Council banned most of these experiments. His mouth cavity is roughly 1/2 cubic meter large. That's just an estimate. I could give you an exact measurement, but I'd rather not get that intrusive. His eyes are smaller than normal and relatively pupilless. They have a rather cold, cunning look to them. Although judging by his speech patterns, any sign of intelligence is probably coincidental.
All I could hope for now was that Man Mountain would find a way to strangle Harv when he was finished with me.
Oh, and he also has a psi-blocking device in his left ear.
I shot a glance and all the thought I could muster toward Carol. She read my mind like a billboard and sprang into action.
Hey, Harv! This guy sure has a bright future, doesn't he?
What?
A bright future? A really, really bright future?
Yes, well, from the look of things, it's a much brighter future than that of the boss.
Ay, caramba! Harv, flash him!
Oh, I get it.
With that, the giant wall screen behind me strobed to bright white, and the light flash hit Man Mountain like 1,000 megawatts slap in the corneas. He turned his head and covered his eyes with a massive forearm, loosening his grip on my throat, and more importantly, freeing my right hand. I plunged my free hand deep into his ear, not the most wonderful experience, and quickly dug around for the psi blocker. I was in halfway up to my forearm before I latched onto what I hoped was the device and pulled it free with a flourish. As Man Mountain began to recover, I held the psi blocker high in the air for Carol to see. She smiled and kicked her psi powers into high gear.
Drop him!
Man Mountain froze in his tracks and his eyes glazed over. Carol had locked onto his mind like a cute little vice, and without the blocker, he was putty in her hands. He loosened his grip on my throat.
Turn around!
Man Mountain obeyed.
I'm going to hit you so hard it's going to knock you out cold.
Then she tapped him with her finger. She puffed on the tip of her finger like a gunfighter.
Nice work!
Thanks, Teal.
What about me, boss?
We'll talk about it later, Harv.
On the other side of the room, Fuzzface slowly regained his senses. He reached his hand towards his blaster on the floor. The special handle read his signature palm print and sprang to life. He smiled and switched the blaster to full power.
Johnson!
I turned toward him, and a look of abject terror passed over my face.
Who's laughing now?
The energy beam hit me full on, punched a hole through my chest, and splattered my insides against the wall. Fuzzface reveled in his violent, glorious victory. Then he woke up.
Huh?
And when he did, he found himself bound to my chair by 4 meters of electromagnetically generated force chains. Stupid Ape was beside him, also tightly bound, but still unconscious, and dreaming of tapioca pudding. Don't ask me why. We didn't have chains big enough for Man Mountain, so we stuck him in the bathroom and threw a force field around the whole thing. This was really gonna run up my power bill.
Nice over-the-top dream, wasn't it? Splattering me against the wall. I think you have some serious anger management issues you need to address.
What'd you do to me?
We were inside your head, courtesy of my secretary, the Psy. And I must say, it was pretty lonely in there.
I pulled out of my pocket the Psy blocker that had once been in his ear and dangled it in front of him like a hypnotist's watch.
Now, I'd like some information.
Hack you!
Fine. Carol, if you can stand the draft, go back into this guy's head and tell me his story.
He works for X-Shell.
You freak!
Hey, with the company you keep, I'd be careful with the name calling.
Go to sleep.
You go to...
Harv, net me X-Shell on the vid.
There will be no need for that.
Harv, please try to remember that I'm the human here and you are the machine. Therefore, in theory, you are supposed to do what I tell you to do. Now net me X-Shell right now, or I'll find a computer who knows how to follow a simple command!
There's no need to establish a connection with X-Shell, because you already have an incoming message from BB Star, the chief executive officer of X-Shell.
Oh. Okay. That'll work too. Put it on the screen, please.
As you wish, O human master.
I turned to the wall screen as a vid window opened and a 6-foot streaming image of BB Star flashed on. I'd seen her picture, of course, on Holovision and in the various net news magazines, but I'd never seen her direct link like this before. Mature, graceful, and tremendously attractive, just her presence over the live net seemed to light up the room. She had an elegantly chiseled face framed by long golden hair, which was cut in a businesslike style, yet somehow still added to her allure. She possessed the kind of beauty that seemed untouchable, almost unnatural in some way. Her deep blue eyes surveyed my office through her own vid screen, and she smiled ever so slightly through her full lips.
Bravo, Mr. Johnson. Please send the boys home when they regain consciousness. They will give you no more trouble.
I think instead that I'll send X-Shell the bill for the damage they caused and let you pick up these bozos at the police station.
What's a bozo?
X-Shell will, of course, reimburse you for any collateral damage created by this little test. But it will not be necessary to involve the local authorities.
I'm sorry. Did you say test?
Correct. And congratulations on a splendid performance.
No offense, Miss Star, but I hate tests. Especially ones that involve blasters, assassins, or math.
I run a big company, Mr. Johnson. I do not hire anyone unless I know for certain that they are worth the investment.
I turned to Carol and Harv.
Am I the only one who's confused here?
That's usually the case, boss. This time, though, I'd say no.
I am offering you a job, Mr. Johnson. I will give you all the necessary details when we meet in person. Kindly be in my office in exactly 3 hours.
Why? So your thugs can take a few whacks at me on familiar territory?
Not to worry. You passed the audition. You are in no danger from me.
Yeah, well, thanks for the reassurance, but I'm gonna need a few more details before stepping directly into the lion's den.
I will give you more data when we meet in person. The net is too easy to spoof. Therefore, I look forward to seeing you in now slightly less than 3 hours' time.
I'm sorry, Miss Star. Again, no offense meant. But frankly, you have a thing or two to learn about people management if you think I'm gonna set one foot into your office now, let alone work for you after what you've done here today.
Mr. Johnson, I understand that your normal rate is 5,000 credits per day. While in my employ, I shall pay you 25,000 per day.
He'll be there in 10 minutes.
Harv!
Look, boss, it's either this or the Omega Mart opening. And you have to admit, you're curious here, right?
Fine. Miss Star, I'll see you in 3 hours at your office. But I'm already on your clock. As a matter of fact, I've been on your clock since your goons came through my door.
Fine.
And I'm not taking your case sight unseen. If I don't like the sound of it, then I'm walking with no strings attached.
And all information discussed at the meeting will remain privileged.
Agreed.
And you must come alone, unarmed and without your computer. No weapons or outside communication devices are allowed in my office building.
I can live with that.
Oh, very nice.
Fine then. I look forward to meeting you in person.
The vid window closed. I turned to Carol.
Did you pick up anything?
Sorry, it's hard enough to do over the net under normal conditions. X-Shell probably has all kinds of defenses in their system.
Or she may have an extremely strong mind. Harv, what do you make of the deal?
X-Shell is the largest corporation on the planet. They currently manufacture 55% of all personal, municipal, and governmental electronic hardware, hold patents on the operating systems for 63% of the world's computers, and control 22% of the current soft drink market. Also, last week they completed their purchase of the country of Finland. They have incomparably vast resources and can afford the finest minds and the most advanced equipment in existence. The fact that they now require your services is a clear sign of desperation.
Thanks a gig. And the next time we get attacked by armed thugs, I'm gonna seriously consider letting them put a couple of energy blasts into your wall unit.
No need to get touchy. I'm simply stating that whatever the situation may be, it must be something very dire for Excel to call upon you. And especially so for Miss Starr to do so personally. She is known as a bit of a recluse. Also, I should note here, if I may, that it would take more than a few energy blasts to the main wall screen to destroy me. I have logic and memory boards in numerous locations, and Dr. Poole has backup copies of my singularly original operating system in more than a dozen secure locations around the globe. It's also worth stating that you would be lost without my constant aid and assistance.
Yeah, paradise lost. Now come on, we have 3 hours to do our prep work.
Where are you going?
You're the Psi, you figure it out.
You're going to Dr. Poole's lab to get your armor repaired and to get background information on BB Starr and her security.
Bingo.
You're also regretting that second burrito you had for breakfast, and you have a particularly graphic picture of my Aunt Electra in some kind of lace negligee in your subconscious.
I think you dug a little too deeply that time.
Tell me about it.
I left my office and walked along the docks toward my bright red 2030 Ford Mustang. It's a classic, although as Harv constantly reminds me, slightly outdated piece of machinery. As I walked, I couldn't help wondering what it must have been like here on the docks decades ago, before teleportation devices turned the docks from bustling, grimy places filled with grunts and groans to an overcrowded tourist attraction filled with the whirs and hums of recording devices. That's one of the perks that comes with being the last private eye on the planet. I get to ponder things like this and pass it off as moire. Unfortunately, the atmosphere was abruptly interrupted by the arrival of what I consider to be the most hideous pustule on the underbelly of the New World Order. Crime syndicates, killer mutations, and guilds of assassin cyborgs may be bad, but they're nothing compared to the monster that I was about to face. The press. They swarmed me like flies on a day-old road apple. Wait a minute. That makes me look bad. They were more like flies on a fresh Twinkie. Yeah, a charismatic Twinkie. We still have Twinkies, by the way. Some of them left over from the 20th century. These weren't actual organic human being journalists, of course. With all the so-called newsworthy events happening in the world today, news people just don't have time anymore to actually be anywhere. God forbid they're interviewing me in Frisco when an Elvis clone slips in his bathtub in New Vegas and they get scooped by the net dude on another bandwidth. Most journalists now have a dozen or so press bots to cover their beats. Press bots are low-tech androids programmed to mimic the owner's voice and personality, equipped with direct audio-visual feeds to the central studio. This way, a journalist can chase a dozen stories at the same time while remaining in the cool, safe comfort of his or her office. Truth to tell, it's only a matter of time before the net news execs realize that they only really need the press bots and toss all the actual human reporters out on their collective earpieces. When that happens, there'll be almost as many vapid personalities on the unemployment line as there were during the great budget crunch of 2017, when the old U.S. government laid off the House of Representatives. One of the press bots thrust himself, mic first, into my face and smiled through robotic teeth.
Mr. Johnson! Mr. Johnson! I'm Bill Gibbon III from Entertainment This Nano. There was a report of a commotion in your office 10 minutes ago. Care to comment?
Not to worry, Mr. Baboon.
That's Gibbon.
It wasn't a real commotion. Just a full contact rehearsal for my upcoming Made for HV special, Zachary Nixon Johnson versus the Cheap Thugs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.